Now, okay, so I go to share my presentation as usual.
Let's mute the mics.
Excuse me?
Let's mute the mics. Let's mute the microphones.
Yeah, you're right. You're right. So let me mute everybody so that, okay. And then of course I will unmute all when we are finished. Okay. So now you are all mute. Okay. Okay, so now we can really start. Okay, here we go. Okay, so today, as I introduce in my posting international, we will talk about, in particular, this artist, whose name is, I suppose in German, the right pronunciation is Paul Klee, I suppose. Maybe someone will correct me if I'm wrong. So it's Paul Klee. And we are talking about a Swiss artist. So he was born in 1879 in Bern, which is a nice city right in the middle of Switzerland. And he was born in 1879, so we are talking about an artist who was contemporary of Pablo Picasso, the last artist we saw last time. Because Picasso was born in 1881, so there were 2 years of difference. In fact, the two artists met each other more than once. The first time when Klee went to Paris at the beginning of the 20th century. And then also he received a visit by Picasso later in the 1935, something like that. So they knew each other. But of course, we are talking about two completely different artists and two completely different kind of art expression. We have seen last time that Picasso was an exuberant artist. Also, someone says a very narcissist, which is true. And his way of painting was very, I would say, explosive. While, as you can see here from the Paul Klee face expression, we have in front a more introvert person, as you can see, probably more sensitive at the same time. And of course, keep in mind that we completely changed the geography. So far we have seen artists from the south of Europe, and we saw once Velázquez, then Pablo Picasso, then Paul Cézanne. So they are all from areas of Europe where the sun shines and the weather is very warm, so that the result is that their art expression is very warm as well. While here we are moving on the other side of the Alps, so we have a different climate, we have different people, different characters, German-oriented. The winds blow from the very north of Europe. So even the art expression is totally different. So while, as I said, with Cézanne, Picasso, we had very warm colors, we had an explosiveness of colors, and not only colors, also feelings, sentiments. Here, of course, the art expression gets more, I would say, psychological. Remember that here we are getting closer to those areas, those cities where Sigmund Freud grew up, also Friedrich Nietzsche, the writer. So, of course, there is a cultural environment that is totally different. But it's very fascinating as well. So a different kind of expression, but extremely fascinating. So after saying that, let's have a look at the artwork I posted on Internations. This is a very nice painting. It is a mature Klee, and it's called Landscape with Yellow Birds. And it's preserved in a private collection in Basel, Switzerland. And yes, I thought that was very meaningful, and it was the right way to present Klee. Just be aware right now that most of the Klee's works are quite small, quite small, as opposed to the Picasso ones, for instance. So whereas Picasso needed a big canvas to represent Guernica, for example, usually the Klee's works are quite small. It means that he used to work in details, you know. He liked very much the details of the canvas. So it's quite rare to face a very big painting by Klee. Usually they are quite small, but so much interesting, you know, even if they are so small, because there is so much work, even in a very small space he used to paint, okay? So having said that, Klee was a lovely watercolorist, you know? And as I told you last time, you know, for my passion of Picasso, I went to get a course in Malaga, where he was born. Same thing I did with when I discovered Klee. So I wanted to know more about the abstract watercolor. So I went to Venezia, and I got a course in acquarello astratto, abstract watercolor. It was 20 years ago. So, but it was a very nice experience for me, and lovely holiday in Venice, you know, during the famous movie exhibition, you know, at the very end of the summertime. But it was one of my best holiday in all my life so far. So as I said, my event today was titled Musician or Painter. Why that? Well, because Paul Klee, his father was a classical music teacher. That means that his father first introduced him to the music, to the classical music. And in fact, Paul Klee, at the very beginning of his career, became a very good violinist. And you can see here a picture, the one here on the right is Paul Klee. And at that time, when he was about 20 years old, he already belonged to the band of his city, and he was a very good violinist. Of course, then, after some years, he realized that he had more talent for painting, so he chose the career of the painting, of the painter. But again, he was at the very beginning a musician. He was a great violinist, and you can see even in his artist career that the music is very often present in his works. So in some way, he always remained a musician, in spite of the fact he was a painter, okay? So music is always present in his life. So this is a self-portrait of from the period in which he was young, when he was around 20 years old. And these are his very first works, you know? And as you can see, they are very particular. So we are not seeing yet what we know about Klee. This is not Klee yet, you know. It is, you can see that there is some kind of Japanese art influence. And also I would say some surrealism. I would say Austrian surrealism. I can recognize something of Egon Schiele, if you know him. So I can see something of Egon Schiele right here in this type of shapes, this type of works, this one, this man on the tree. So very interesting works. But as you can see here, the color is quite missing. The color, which is so characteristic of Paul Klee, is quite missing. It's like that he has not met the color yet, okay? But nevertheless, these works are so interesting, I would say, in any case. This is a very nice self-portrait. It looks like very much like an expressionist work. So following the expressionism, the German expressionism of that time. I was thinking about organizing another event on the expression, because it's another chapter of this of the contemporary art. And in this period, 1911, he illustrated the Candide of Voltaire with these nice drawings. And I can see in this drawing also of his compatriot, the sculptor Giacometti. I don't know if you have in mind the Giacometti sculpture. He used to sculpture this type of figures, so very tall, very thin. So it reminds me, the very first click here reminds me very much his compatriot Giacometti. And again, this is the complete illustration of the Candide of Voltaire. So they are also kind of comic drawings. And this is quite an interesting period. So Klee here is around 30 years old, 1911, 1912. This is a period also in which he got in touch with great German painters like Kandinsky and other expressionists like Franz Marc and August Mucke, don't know exactly the right pronunciation, but those were the people who founded the famous movement, which is called, I think in German is Der Blaue Rider, something like that, which in Italian is Il Cavaliere Azzurro, in English is The Blue Rider, and it's a very famous movement, and Paul Klee joined that movement that was born after another important movement was born a few years before in Dresden, that was called Die Brücke, the bridge, and it was funded by the pure expressionists like Kirchner and other people. So again, in this period, he got in touch with this other very famous painter, a very talented painter, who was Kandinsky, the Russian painter. And also he read a famous work, I can show it to you here, which is called, it's a very famous book that Vasily Kandinsky wrote, which is called The Spiritual in Art. There are so many theories in this book. I can show it to you maybe here. I have it. Maybe let me see if you can see it. You know, this one with the painting of Kandinsky. And of course, all the theories that are explained here influenced very much Klee as well. And their friendship also started in this period and developed more later. We will see that. 1912 is an important year because this is the year in which Paul Klee goes to Paris. He will meet the people, the great artists who were there. For instance, Pablo Picasso, I said, but not only him. He was particularly influenced, he really liked very much this artist whose name is Robert Delaunay. I don't know if you have already heard of him, but he is known for being a different type of cubist. So he joined the cubist movement of Picasso, but he developed a totally different aspect of the cubism. So while Picasso and Braque as well were very much interested in developing the real structure of the object, of the things. In fact, their colors were more the browns. Robert Delaunay developed what is called Orphic Cubism, and it was more, he was more focused on the colors and how the colors could express on the canvas. And that was really influential for Klee. In fact, these are the very first work after this visit in Paris of Klee. And you can see there is many colors, flashing colors. And certainly we can see a mix of cubism, Orphic Cubism, and also Fauve. The Fauve was the movement in which, to which Matisse, Henri Matisse joined. And this is a kind of mix. Also here we see the card players, which is a theme we have seen typical of Cézanne. Cézanne was also very much influential for Paul Klee. And this is so that the clue of this period. But then what was really a key period for Power Clee to become the Clee we know today, so the Clee that became so famous for so many masterpieces and so such a beautiful style, it was a journey in Tunisia. So in 1914, he traveled throughout Tunisia. He was hosted by a Swiss doctor there. He went, by the way, with another artist whose name was Auguste Macke. He was a typical expressionist. He was his friend. And after this visit in Tunisia, Paul Klee started painting like this here. You know, this is a watercolor, so beautiful. Let me zoom on it because it deserves to be seen very well. You can see here, such a beautiful watercolor. And here on the right, you can see the Cézanne influence on Klee. You see, here we have seen the Saint-Victoire, the mountain he painted during the last years of his life. So the beginning of the 20th century, let's say 1905, 1906. And this is Klee. So we can see that both of them are using patches of colors, you know, to do something which is amazing. You know, this is a cubist work, but so I would say so meaningful, no, so intense from the expressiveness point of view. And these are other watercolors of that period after the Tunisia journey. You can see here they are so amazing, I would say. Just patches of color, patches, and be aware that it's tough to find a Klee work which is not extremely high quality. Everything has a very high quality, I would say. He painted at the end of his career thousands of works, but it started to find just only one which is not high quality. You can see here these colors, how they are located next to each other, and they are so intense, in my opinion. So this is a typical also Tunisian landscape, this one as well, just patches of color with these nice doves right here. And this is the Klee of this period. This is the period in which Klee starts to be the painter he wanted to be. Then, of course, we go to 1920, which is a very important year for Klee, because he was called by the founder of the Bauhaus Academy School. This is a, you know, the Bauhaus was an architecture school that was founded by this man right here on the right, whose name was Walter Gropius. He was an architect, and he joined together many artists of that period, and he built up this amazing school, and from this school so many masterpieces came out, not only paintings, but also many architecture works, many also design works, and that was a fundamental period, not only for the painting history, but all the art design history as a whole. So you can see here a picture in which we have on the right Walter Gropius. Here on the left we have Vasily Kandinsky. This is Kandinsky's wife. And here you can see here next to Walter Gropius, Paul Klee. So this is the period in which Klee and Kandinsky got friends, and also they painted some works for hands, you know, together. So these are, for instance, three paintings they painted together, four hands. You can recognize the style of both the two painters in these works, which are so interesting, I would say. So the Bauhaus, so interesting. Remember that it was founded in 1919 in Weimar. Then they moved in 1925 to Dessau, But then, of course, when the Nazis started to get popular, to gain power in the country, and Hitler took the power, they were forced to close. They were forced to close the school. The school, the academy, was closed in 1933, when basically the Hitler's power started to be so strong. They were not, the Nazis movement totally didn't like the type of art expression that came out from this academy. So they were first to close the school, and some of them also to run away, to escape from Germany, because they were persecuted. In this period, so we are talking about 10 years, from 1920 until 1930, 10 years period. This is a very important period for Klee. This is a period in which his production is probably one of the best of his career. And here you can see this painting, which is the only one we have in Milano. So this painting, which is called Wald Bau, basically forest, it is preserved in Museo del Novecento in Milano. It's the only one we have here in Milano, but it's extremely valuable. It's a very interesting work. And here you can see the Klee and his theories. In this phrase I put here, art does not reproduce visible things, but makes visible. In this phrase, there is much, understanding Klee is very much in this phrase. He mentioned several times. So it means that, I'll try to explain the phrase, because it's very related also to the philosophy of the phenomenological philosophy I already mentioned with Cézanne. It comes back here with Klee. In fact, Klee and Cézanne are in some way similar from the theoretical point of view. And it means that, think about it. What he wanted to search was not only what is visible, but also what is not visible. So if you think about it, whatever is visible for us is not only what is what counts. There is many things that are not visible. There is always something that is invisible together with what is visible. Same thing with the sound. So whatever we say, there is always something that is unsaid, that can be even very often more important than what we say, you know. So the silence has some kind of importance. So this is the idea in the phenomenological tradition. So we have to discover what is not visible, what is the invisible, and it's there. It's only to be discovered. Also, this is another phrase saying a lot about this painter. It said, "I heard some days that it was the trees that look at me, that spoke to me. I was there listening." So what's happening here is that there is a switch between the subject and the object. So usually when you paint something, you try to reproduce something, in this case, for instance, a forest. So the forest becomes for you the object that you want to represent as a subject. But here this phrase says something else. It says that I can become an object for what I consider before an object, and he becomes the subject. So in this case he's saying, it's not me the subject, it's the trees that were the subject, and me, and I was the object trying to listen to them. So there is a totally switching between the subject and the object, which is typical of the phenomenological tradition. They wanted to break the phenomenologists, like Merleau-Ponty, I mentioned last time. They totally wanted to break this separation between subject and object. They wanted some time to switch them, and possibly not to talk about them at all, you know? Why we have to talk about subject and object? Let's mix them. Let's pretend that they don't exist as a separate. So that was the case in this case. So the result of this theory, which is trying to represent the invisible, is this one you can see here. So we have a mix of something which is recognizable and something else which is not, which is pure fantasy. Have a look here. Of course, as usual, we have a magnificent use of the color, you know? The way Klee uses the color is simply amazing. There is so much talent. Look at those blues here. But also these figures, you know, some of them we can recognize them. Here we can see a fish, of course, but then we can see other also here there is a fish. But then there are many other entities we cannot recognize because they come totally from the fantasy of the artist. One thing more, this is a famous phrase he mentioned in a conference in 1924 in Jena. So here we are in the middle of the period he spent in Germany at the Bauhaus. So that is period. He used to teach, of course, he was a teacher in the academy. And this is a famous phrase he mentioned in that conference where he used a metaphor for the artist. He said, an artist is very similar to a tree. So the tree is composed by roots, you know, the roots of the tree are what usually the artist, where he usually gets the impressions, you know, the visible, what stimulates him, you know, what is around him. So everything comes from the roots. He is nourished by what is coming from the roots. But then there is the trunk. The trunk is like the individual. So the artist seen as individual. So elaborating all the stimulations he receives by the root. And then whatever is on the top of the tree has nothing to do with the roots. So there is no relationship between the crown of the tree and his roots, you know? So whatever is on the top of the root of the tree is pure creation, is pure creativity, is totally new, and it has nothing to do with the roots. So that's why, from what we understand, we need to change our attitude when we are in front of a painting, in particular a Klee painting, and we try to understand what he wanted to say. So for instance, what he wanted to say here, sometimes it's not the right way to understand a painting, because as Klee tried to explain, an artwork, a painting, is a pure creation, is a pure... Is pure fantasy coming out. So we sometimes have to enjoy an artwork, not trying to understand what he wanted to say, but just as a new creation. Like you can see outside from your window, when you see a beautiful landscape, what do you have to understand? You don't have to understand anything. You just see this this amazing creation. Same thing with the artwork. So this type of painting is just beautiful because of the colors, because of these extremely refined figures. Look at this painting. The blues, the greens are so refined. Same thing for these fantastic figures he used to paint. Here we have the Navigator, 1923. And then here we have the Lover. So this representation with this strange entity. Of course, we have a head, and his brain, there is the shape of, I suppose, a woman. So he was kind of obsessed, you know, by this this woman. She was always in his thinking. And then this is another very meaningful work. It's called Mask with Flag. And it's very funny because we can see here a set of geometric figures plus a kind of spring reds, and the result is this type of face with a strange expression, so difficult to interpret, right? But nevertheless, there are so many feelings coming out from the painting. So this also reminds in some way some works from the divisionist movement, like you know, the Signac and Seurat works in Paris, but also our painters like there is one now I missed the name. Never mind. In any case, it looks very much like a divisionist work. And then here on the next slides, I've posted the three which are considered three masterpieces by Klee. And this is another phrase coming from his conference. He said, "The viewer's eye must move on the painting like a grazing sheep," which means that the time dimension enters the visual world, which means that in the Klee's work, which is really new, I would say, in the art history, there is the time duration that enters in the work. It is like that we as spectators are supposed to spend time trying to having a journey on the painting. So there are some suggestions to walk on the painting and trying to enjoy a journey on the painting. This is a masterpiece which is the attempt to represent on canvas with colors a music, a polyphony. In fact, it's called Escape in Red, Fuga in Rosso in Italian, which is a type of classical music. So this is the graphical representation, which is amazing because you can see the music. This painting really, it seems that it is expressing music, a polyphony. This painting has sounds. You know, it's not a simple representation of geometric features and colors. There is music inside. And then this is another important work by Klee. It's called, so this is the as I said, always the 10 years in Germany. This is called Main Road and Second.